In this video lecture, we'll take a look at the structure, flowcharts, and examples of both kinds of while looping in Java. Okay, let's get started. As we've said previously, in event-driven looping, we repeat the same set of instructions over and over again, except on different data each time. However, when we begin such looping, we don't know in advance how many times we're going to need to perform that set of instructions. Something needs to tell us when we're done, and that something is called an event. An event is some sort of signal, some thing that happens, which tells our code that it can stop looping. For example, in the grocery cashier example discussed previously, encountering the divider bar on the conveyor belt is the event which tells that all our groceries have been scanned. In simple user input, an event might be the read of some special value, such as a -1 or a Q keyboard input. If we're reading from a file, then the event would be that we've reached the end of the file. No matter what form the event takes, we incorporate this event into our loop's logical condition to determine whether or not to make another pass through the loop. There are two kinds of event-driven looping in Java, the while loop and the do-while loop. While both types have a very similar structure, there is one key difference. In while loops, the condition is located and is checked at the beginning of the loop. Therefore, the statements of the loop may or may not be executed. In fact, if the loop condition is false on the first iteration, the loop body might not be executed at all. By contrast, in do-while loops, the condition is located and is checked at the end of the loop. This means that we have to traverse the loop statements at least one time to get to that condition, and so the loop body is guaranteed to be executed at least one time. Let's take a look and see what this means visually. For comparison and contrast, here are the flowcharts for both the while loop and the do-while loop. These flowcharts are largely identical, except for the placement of the loop condition, represented by the blue diamond. In the while loop, the condition is evaluated for the first time before reaching the loop body. If the condition is true, then all of the statements in this loop body are executed, after which we go back to reevaluate the condition and see if we do it again. As long as this condition remains true, we keep going through this loop and executing this body of statements. But once this condition becomes false, we bypass the loop body and continue on with whatever statements follow the loop. So if this condition evaluates to false on the very first pass through, it's possible that this loop body will get bypassed entirely. By contrast, in the do-while loop, the condition is located after the loop body, which means that we have to traverse this block of statements at least once before reaching the condition. Once we get to this point, the operation is identical to the while loop. We evaluate this condition, and as long as it remains true, we keep going through this loop and executing this body of statements, until finally this condition becomes false and we continue on with the statements following the loop. So with a do-while loop, we are guaranteed to execute the body of the loop at least one time. Before we get to the nitty-gritty or any examples of the two kinds of loops, first let's establish some common terminology to both loops. The loop body is the block of statements which gets executed on each pass through the loop. An iteration is simply one execution pass through the loop body, or loosely referred to as one loop or one pass. The priming read is the initial setup or read of any necessary data before beginning any looping, enough to get the loop underway for the first time. A sentinel value represents some specific special data value we might be checking for to help determine the continuation or termination of the loop. Sentinel values are typically very recognizable values such as these. For example, 0, -1, the letter Q, and so forth. A loop continuation condition is simply the Boolean condition or expression within parentheses which tells us whether or not to perform another iteration of our loop. As long as it evaluates to true, we keep on looping. A loop termination condition, by contrast, is simply some Boolean condition or expression which describes the conditions under which our loop should stop iterating. Sometimes it's easier or more natural to describe a loop in terms of the specific condition under which it should cease executing, but any loop structure requires a continuation condition. Fortunately, the loop continuation and termination conditions are simply the logical negatives of each other, as shown by the NOT operator in both these expressions. We'll see examples of going back and forth between these in some coming lecture materials. Finally, the loop update is any statement or set of statements that might modify the loop's data in such a way that could cause the loop continuation condition to evaluate to false on the next iteration, and thereby cause termination of the looping. If a loop condition is currently true, unless we have some sort of loop update statement or statements to potentially turn it false, our loop will never stop executing. Forgetting to add some sort of loop update at the end of our loop body is a very common mistake and gotcha in programming, and leads to infinite looping. We'll see examples of this in some later materials. Here again is the flowchart for the while loop and the corresponding code structure for it. Prior to a while loop, we have the usual initialization of any variables, but part of that should now include any needed priming read, the initialization of any data needed to get the loop underway for the first pass. The loop begins with this while keyword, followed by this conditional expression within parentheses. Remember that this condition represents the continuation condition, not the termination condition. The condition, of course, is represented by the blue diamond in the flowchart. If the continuation condition evaluates to logical true, then we move on to execute all the statements within this pair of curly braces, which is the loop body shown in the flowchart here. The statements taken together represent one logical block of code, and as always, per good coding convention, notice that they are indented. Everything within any pair of curly braces should always be uniformly indented. Near the tail end of the loop body, we require some sort of loop update statement, because that's what gives this condition the chance to possibly evaluate to logical false when we go back up here to reevaluate the condition. If the condition is still true, we execute the loop body one more time. But once the condition evaluates to false, that's the event we were speaking of earlier, and that's what signals us that the looping is done, and we then proceed to whatever statements follow the loop, represented by this continuation block in green. That's it. That's how a while loop operates. So summing up the operation of a while loop as shown on the previous slide, we first perform a priming read to initialize any data needed by the loop or its condition. Then we evaluate the loop condition. If the loop condition is true, we execute all the while loop statements and we perform the loop update, which gives the loop condition its first chance to evaluate to false for the next pass. Then we reevaluate the loop condition, and if it's still true, we go through the loop one more time. Remember that if there's some sentinel value we're checking for, that value will be incorporated into the condition and possibly updated by the loop update. But the first time the loop condition evaluates to false, loop iteration ends, and we're done with our while loop. Here's a simple example of while looping using a sentinel-controlled user input. In this example, we're simply prompting the user for some number, then echoing it out and reprompting over and over again until the user enters a particular ending value. Notice that we're setting up a sentinel value of -1 and a prompt message which incorporates it. Then this read of num serves as our priming read outside and before the while loop begins. Upon entering the while loop, we first check our continuation condition. Is the current value of num something other than the sentinel value? Yes or no? If the answer is true, we enter the loop, echo the just entered value of num, and then reprompt for the new value of num. So this then is our update read inside the loop. By continuing to read new values for num, we give this continuation condition a chance to eventually become false. Once it does, when num is finally equal to the sentinel value of -1, we terminate the looping, print this post-loop termination message, and then we are done with the example. Some sample output from running this example for various input values is shown here at the bottom. To see this example execute in a little more detail, please take a moment now to pause this video and view the short code walkthrough for loopingwhilesentinel.java, which you'll find in the usual place. Open up this file in JGrasp so you can follow along, then come back to this video when you are finished. By contrast, here again is the flowchart for the do while loop and the corresponding code structure for it. Just like for the while loop, we have the initialization of any variables, but part of that now including any needed priming read to get the loop underway for the first pass. Now the loop begins instead with the do keyword, then followed by the body of the loop as before. Now this block of statements is guaranteed to be executed at least one time, and again near the tail end, we have some sort of loop update statement, which potentially gives the condition a chance to become false. But this time, the loop body closing curly brace is followed by the while keyword, followed by the conditional expression within parentheses. And notice that this time the condition is followed by a semicolon to mark the end of this entire statement. As before, remember that this condition represents the continuation condition, not the termination condition, and it is of course represented by the blue diamond in the flowchart. Just as for the while loop, we then evaluate this continuation condition, and if it evaluates to logical true, we then loop back around and evaluate the statements of this block one more time. But if it's false, again that's the event which tells us we are done looping, and we continue on to any following statements. The main difference with the do while loop is that we are guaranteed to evaluate all these loop block statements at least one time, even if the condition is false upon its first evaluation. Everything else, including the standard indentation of all statements within the curly brace pair, is pretty much identical to the while loop form. And that's it. That's how a do while loop gets executed. So to sum up the operation of a do while loop as shown on the previous slide, everything about it is identical to the while loop, except that we are guaranteed to evaluate the loop body at least one time, because we evaluate the loop condition after we evaluate the loop body. Then same as before, if the loop continuation condition is true, we make one more iteration of the loop body, and we continue to do so as long as the loop condition continues to evaluate to true. Remember that each time through the loop, towards the end, we perform the loop update statements, which give the loop condition a chance to finally become false. Once the loop condition does evaluate to false, loop iteration ends, and as before, we're done with our do while loop. Here's another example of looping, to perform user input validation this time. Here we want to ensure that the user enters a value over the specified range 1 to 10, and we'll use the do while loop to keep dogging the user until they enter a valid number in that range. This example is a bit more involved than the prior one, so I think I'll defer the detailed explanation to the code walkthrough for this one. Nonetheless, note the key aspects of this do while loop. This input read is within the loop and serves as both a priming read and the update read. We have the continuation condition at the end of the loop, and it checks whether the current input is outside of the allowable range. If that's the case, we'll go back around for another iteration, over and over again, until the number is within range and this continuation condition finally fails. So at this time, please finish this video and view the short code walkthrough for looping while bounds check.java, which you'll find in the usual place. Open up this file in JGrasp so you can follow along. And with that, we'll conclude this discussion of the basic mechanics of the while and do while loops. Next, we'll take a look at more applications involving while loops.